I'm so proud to be a fan of your band.
Oh, Joe, man, thank you so much. You're blowing my mind right now. This is, I hope someone's recording this. I need to show this to my friends. I need evidence.
Planet Rock. Dave Grohl!
Oh,
if I live and breathe!
This is amazing.
How are you, mate?
How are you?
I'm good. Nice to meet you.
I know. I can't believe it. Oh my God. The guys in my band are gonna lose their mind. You have no idea. This is a hero moment I'm having right now. This is great.
Well, you know, Phil, I was talking to Phil about 3 weeks ago. He says, I've just been to see the Foos down at Mates, and Pat Smear's playing one of my guitars.
It's true. Like,
what? Fantastic.
He was like a kid on Christmas morning. It was great. How are you?
Yeah, it's the 6 degrees of the Kevin Bacon thing. There's always some kind of connection somewhere with everybody, even if you've never met them. You know, there's somebody knows somebody knows somebody.
Small,
you know,
world. Small rock.
You're looking
and roll
good,
world.
Bud.
I've
been told that we've got to stay on track here, apparently, because shameless plug. Look at this. it came through the door yesterday morning, right? So have I read it? No. Have I read the liner thing where you say that you measure your life in musical increments? Hallelujah. You're not the only one.
Right? Isn't that the way?
I mean, everything I judge is by, you know, years, days, months of artists' records in the past, catalog numbers.
Yeah, whatever, same. You know, so. I mean, I think that, you know, some people have they recall things through the sense of like smell or it's visual. With me, it's complete, it's totally music. And I can vividly remember things by a song will come on the radio and I'll remember where I was the first time I heard it or where I was the first time I recorded it, things like that. And it makes life a lot easier. You know, you wind up with that musical file cabinet in your mind. And I mean, it's the same with you. I'm sure you remember album by album what you were going through at the time, where you were in your life. And whenever one of those songs comes on the radio, it just brings you back to that moment when they hit record.
Completely right. But it's not just our stuff, it's everybody's stuff. If I hear Every Picture Tells a Story by Rod Stewart, I remember because it was the first album I ever bought with my own spending money. I can remember exactly what it smelt like, what the weather was like, the brown paper bag that I carried it home in and all that. In fact, I think I tossed that away because I wanted to look cool on the bus because it was okay to like Rod Stewart in 1971. You know, I mean, it is. It's absolutely right. And can I also add, before we get totally into the book, the new album is, in my humble opinion, the best thing you guys have ever done.
It is thank
absolutely
you so much.
Outrageously stunning. In fact, just to quantify that, I was asked recently to put my top 100 favorite songs of all time. I mean, we're talking going back to 64 for a playlist on Spotify, and Waiting for a War is in my top 100.
Oh, man.
And at the time I did it, it was about 3 weeks old. So to me.
Thank you so much. So, well, I appreciate that. No,
amazing record.
I think we finally got to the place where we didn't feel so tied to all the things that we had done before. You know, like sometimes when you make a record, you feel some sort of obligation, like, well, we can't completely like disregard all the things we've done before. And this time we just felt free to make something that sounded different than anything we've really done. There are moments that are recognizable, but for the most part, and that was so liberating to be able to go in the studio and say, okay, like, let's forget about the last 26 years and let's start now. Imagine this was the first record. Let's take it from here. I really appreciate that.
Yeah, to me, you've taken a leaf out of Queen's book where they weren't ever a metal band. They were a hard rock band on Queen 1, Queen 2. Then they started to branch a little bit on Sheer Heart Attack. Yeah, we had the Now I'm Ears and the Brighton Rocks, but we also had Bring Back Leroy Brown, which was like vaudeville, you know. And that moved them off to the point where we didn't know what we were going to get next, you know. I hear your new Foos album is like the jazz period of Queen.
Really? I like to think that it's our hot space, actually. I always thought it was kind of
I'd go back a couple of years before then, but it's brilliant. So this, right? This is not exactly an autobiography, is it, as such?
Well, it's funny because
in the traditional sense of like, I was born in Springfield and here I am.
Yeah, I
mean, no. It says Storyteller, so I mean, you go off on tangents.
It started when everything shut down last March. We were about to release that record. We were about to hit the road. We had the shows lined up. It was our 25th anniversary last year. So we had booked this like worldwide tour. And then everything stopped. And I thought, well, I can't just do nothing. So I started writing for this. I started an Instagram page, which I'd never done. And I just wanted to write stories and put them on this page. It's called Dave's True Stories. And after I'd written like three or four of them, they were all short stories, so maybe 5 or 6,000 words. I started thinking, well, I'm going to be here for a while. So I might as well just write a book. I finally have time. And I'd made a list of 30 or 40 short stories that I was going to write for the Instagram page. And I just handed that to the editor. And I said, okay, you tell me what you want me to write. And they would assign me two or three stories. And then I just kind of blast them out, send them. They'd assign me three or four more stories. I'd blast them out, send them. So I wasn't writing in any sort of like conventional chronological frame. I was just kind of just writing these short stories. And then it was compiled in a way that it made sense. There's structure to it. So there is a beginning and there is an end. And there's no way that you could tell the entire story in 380 pages. There's just no way you could do it. No. So it was more a matter of just kind of painting this picture that's more emotional than logistical, and it's informational, but it's more like, and I'm sure you feel this way, that all of these incredible experiences that you've had, it's almost like having an out-of-body experience. It's almost like watching your life happen to someone else. And so there's moments like right now, like I can't believe I'm talking to you right now. It's these sort of things where I just feel like I'm watching this happen to someone else. So writing in that way, yeah, it's not like just a conventional rock bio. It's more of just like an emotional collection of these stories.
Do you feel then that with the book, it was liberating because of COVID? Was it because it was like the mega big red reset button for the entire planet? But as an artist, you're stopped in your tracks from doing what you love the most, which is communicating with your audience there and then. You know, instant gratitude both ways. Now we have to reinvent how we do everything. So what am I going to do? I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll write a book.
Yeah.
Oh, and I'll write a new album as well. I mean, where do you get your energy?
It's all coffee. It's just coffee. No, I mean,
hallelujah, listen to that, buddy.
Cheers. I know. Where's my cup? I honestly feel like, you know, we have this opportunity to live. Right? We wake up every day and you're blessed to have one more day. And it's up to you what you're going to do with it. Whether it's the worst day of your life or the most beautiful day of your life, you've got one more. And so why not take advantage of that time while you have it? And I look at all of this opportunity that I have to like bring joy and to bring laughter and to bring happiness and to connect with people as you do when you play live. Just to be able to sort of to share with others. I really love doing that. Every day when I wake up, I have a new idea of how to do it. And last year, of course, the world changed. So you had to adapt. Most people like turned inward, right? Because you couldn't go out. So everyone turned inward and they started like discovering who they are and what they're all about. It was like an existential crisis. And to me, I mean, having that time to be able to sit down and reflect and put those things on paper, it was great. It was life-changing. It really was, you know? Yeah. And I'd still, when I wake up every day, I think, okay, what comes next? You know, this was probably the most time I've ever spent thinking about the past. You know, I'm constantly reminded of it by the music and things that you like hear or see in public, but I'm more concerned with like the forward motion of doing things. Having that time was actually really good.
We as artists have this strange kind of, if you become successful, you're tied to your past. Like, for example, it doesn't matter whether it's McCartney or the Stones, you can't go and see the Rolling Stones like, say, last couple of nights ago in St. Louis in some football stadium and say, okay, we're going to play you 12 tracks for my new album.
That's not ever going to work.
You know, people will indulge you every 30 minutes, a new song sort of thing, unless you're in a club, then you can get away with it, play your entire album. But if you're going to go out there, you've got to play Street Fighting Man, Jumping Jack Flash. You know, for you guys, you've got to play, you know, hit after hit after hit and still mingle it in with the new stuff as well. And, you know, I find that gathering information from all my friends, all my colleagues, and just reading articles, because I've got more time to do that now, from other artists, it seems to have been a time for innovation and renovation.
This is absolutely true.
Everybody, I can't get a plumber, I can't get a builder. You know, everybody wants to renovate because they've got this time on their hands. But at the same time, they're having somebody else do it while they're sat in the corner with a Fostex, you know, drum machine or four-track digital recorder doing demos, you know, which is what we've been doing. We've been writing. We've been just writing fools, because we didn't want the year to go to waste. We had this tour lined up with Motley and Poison and Joan Jett. It got blown off.
Oh, you didn't get to do it.
And now it's rescheduled for next year. So it's now on third time lucky, you know. And so what are you going to do? Well, like you, we were not going to let this time go to waste. So we've been working and working and working, and there's things in the pipeline. And I can't say any more than that. But, you know, it's a case of like, just grasping the nettle, really, because you've got all this time, and the worst thing that you or I could do is sit there and waste it.
Can't do it. I cannot do it. I mean, that's, you know, everyone, all of my friends always
keep them as far apart as possible.
Yeah. All my friends, they always laugh at me. They're like, God, you're so busy right now. And I'm like, yeah, but you know what? After this month, it's going to slow down. And they just start laughing. They're like, you've been saying that for 25 years because it never really does. And there's a part, actually in the book, I talk about how, like, when Nirvana first became popular, my father called and he said, you know, this isn't going to last, right? And I said, no, of course. Like, why? This could never last. This is too good to be true. And he said, you got to treat every check you make like it's the last one you're ever going to make. Okay, because this will not last. And so I thought, like, okay, good. I've got maybe a couple years of this, and then I'll resume normal life. And I thought, like, at some point, this will stop, and I'll go and resume normal life. I'll become a father. I'll have a family. I'll get a real job. I won't be a drummer anymore. So whatever. And it just keeps going and going and going. And then you realize, like, oh no, this is real life. I mean, it sounds crazy, but my life I consider to be just as normal as anyone else's. I just do this instead of that.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know,
I get that.
Hey, time is short. Like, you have to take advantage of the time that you have.
Completely agree. When we were in 1993, when we were just about surviving, you guys, just. And we went and played a gig in our hometown at Don Valley Stadium, 40,000 people. And it was almost to the day 15 years since we formed. And I remember walking out, it was still daylight because it was June, and seeing all these people and actually thinking, I think we could actually do this for as long as we want. Until that moment, it would always been like, well, it's going to come to a sticky end soon. Yeah. You know, because you're born into this thing of like, you know, when we were kids, we watched bands like T-Rex and Bowie and Slade and Sweet. And other than, say, Bowie, they all pretty much had a 5-year shelf life. So that's what you judge yourself on. You to judge yourself against the Who or the Stones, which were at the time 15 years old. Oh, he was like, well, that's, you've been a bit, you know, come on, be real. You know, that doesn't happen to everybody. But all of a sudden, things change. You guys have been a band now for 20, what is it?
It's 26 years now. 26, yeah.
We've been a band for 42. You know, I mean, how crazy is that? You'll get there one day because you are who you are, you know, and there's no getting away from the fact that you guys are around for good.
Well, that's the thing, is I think at some point you have to sort of accept, like, okay, we're in this for the long haul. And I liken it to, like, imagine your grandparents getting a divorce. Like, what the fuck? Like, your grandparents you can't get a divorce. You've been together for fucking 50 years. It's like, it's too late. You can't break up now. And I mean, the thing that I love about being in this band is that we love each other. Like, we are friends, and we still enjoy doing this the same as we did when we first started jamming in our first drummer's basement. You know, like, it still feels the same when we show up to an airport and four vans roll up to put the whole, you know, to pick up the band. We still all jump in one van, you know, because it just feels that way. And of course I would never want it to end. It's too good. I love it so much.
We're blessed. You and I and anybody in this business is blessed to do what we do. And I think there aren't enough people in this world like you, Dave, that know that and run with it and be honest with themselves. There's a lot of people out there that probably think of you as this like punk rocker I think of you as just this humanitarian kind of guy who's embraces love and hate equally, and hopefully the hate with a bit of humor, because it's not really hate. I watch what you guys have done. I've watched how you discuss things with people in these documentaries you make, the humorous tour intro videos that you guys make in gas stations along Route 66 or whatever. These things turn you into a human being and just show that humor is a big part of what we do. You've embraced that more than any band that I can think of that's not a comedy band. And it just brings a completely different dimension to what you guys
do. You know, a lot of that.
Oh, I'm so proud to be a fan of your band.
Oh, Joe, man, thank you so much. You're blowing my mind right now. This is, I hope someone's recording this. I need to show this to my friends. I need evidence.
Again, it's just honesty, bud. It's just me being honest. I've always been a fan of, and you know, the thing that sucks the most is I've never seen your life. I've just never been in the right place at the right time, but I want to put that right next year sometime, even if I have to get a private plane and fly in to watch
one. Oh, we'll just send you ours. No, I mean, you have to come see.
That would be nice.
You have to come see the band because at this point, when we go out and do shows, I mean, we're doing long shows. They're 2.5 or 3 hours long now. And I honestly think, I feel like we're better than we've ever been because of that, like, the year and a half that just passed, like having it taken away. I don't think we ever took it for granted, but it feels like there's this new energy to it that every time we get out to do it, it's, you know, it feels, we feel so fortunate that we can actually get on the stage. The audience feels so fortunate that they can actually see another rock and roll show, because you never know, it might be the last one. And so when you hit the stage now, you have that energy where you're just like, let's play it like it's the last one we'll ever play. It feels so good.
Well, I'm not going to experience that until next year. Next year, I can hopefully experience what you just experienced, but it's never gone away. We've never took it for granted. I've always gone on stage thinking, it's the last show I ever do, I want it to be good. I've never gone on stage blasé. It's always got to be, you've got to live up to your reputation.
Absolutely.
If you're ill, that's one thing, but never be ill-prepared. I mean, it's just, you can't be that guy, you know, so.
Absolutely,
you know,
correct.
The fact that you guys have, you know, you've been on stage with Rick Astley. You've made a Bee Gees record. These are the kind of things where you've got a big, solid brass balls to do that kind of stuff. This is what I admire just as much as all your insane chord structures and rhythms and Taylor's drumming and just the mental, the whole structure of your songs is so unique.
Thank you.
It's actually a pleasure. You know, I mean, now I'm going to, you know what I'm going to do when this interview is over, I'm going to go straight in there, fire up my iPhone on the speakers and just play your back catalog until the sun goes.
Man.
Put me in the mood.
My favorite interview ever. This is really going great. Well, you know, I have to be honest, you know, when talking about the sense of humor, you know, a lot of my favorite rock and roll bands, whether it was The Who or AC/DC, like, they had this tongue-in-cheek sense of humor. Like, when they got down and played their instruments, there was no fucking around. Like, that was no bullshit. Like, they were really playing from the heart. But everything else, there was sort of like this tongue-in-cheek vibe where it made them seem even more like mischievous or like hooligans or something like that, where you're like, those are the kids in high school that you kind of wanted to stay away from, but you know, if you were to hang out with them, you'd have the best night of your life. And so that was, you know, I was one of those kids in school where, you know, I wasn't a great student, of course, but I enjoyed being there. Like, I had this wicked sense of, you know, I felt like a goblin or something like that. And so to be in a rock and roll band, I get it. Like, some bands, you know, they take it very seriously and they want that portrait of like a really beautiful, serious rock band. We've never been like that, because I want to be the one that has like a little wink and a tongue in cheek and, like, you know, give it to it and make you smile, like bring a little joy, but at the same time, like, melt your face. That's kind of what I.
That's why I was always such a big fan of Queen, because they could do Bring Back Leroy Brown and they could do things like, you know, Death on Two Legs. I mean, absolutely. It's like the same band, really. Bonkers. You think of AC/DC with things like Big Balls. I mean, you know.
I just listened to it like a week ago. I was driving around laughing my fucking ass off listening to that song. Like, oh my God, Bon Scott.
He was like the cheekiest guy ever. You know, he was fantastic. We toured with AC/DC on the Highway to Hell tour for about 3 weeks in the UK. And, you know, he was that guy. He was the guy you wanted to hang out with, but at the same time, you wouldn't want to say anything, you know, out of place. Exactly. Because he had muscles, baby. You know, Bon Scott was the boy, you know, I mean, and I'm a big fan. Queen had the humor, AC/DC had the humor. There's not many other bands that have really pulled it off. I don't think you can call the Rolling Stones deadly serious, but they had a tongue-in-cheekness about them that made them as, you know, because they're loose and it's not serious. It's not like prog rock in the sense of like everything has to be exactly perfect.
Well, I kind of thought the same way about the Kinks. You know, I always thought that the Kinks, like, oh, they're, you know, they're taking the piss. Like, you listen to the lyrics of a song, and I mean, of course, like an incredible rock and roll band with these legendary songs, but I'm like, are they joking? I can't tell. Are they kidding? Are they being serious? What are they doing? And I love that about them.
Yeah. And Pete Townsend did the best disguised masturbation song of all time with Pictures of Lily. You know, I mean, the guy was a genius, really. I didn't get it at first because I was like 8 or 9 years old. I didn't even know what that meant, you know, but then eventually it's like, oh, okay. Good one, Pete. Good one. I think we're done. I think they've given me the hook, boy. Dave, absolute pleasure, bud. I can't wait to have a drink with you in real life at some
stage. Yes, please. Joe, it's an honor. I can't wait to see the show, and you got to come out to ours as well.
I will. Anytime. It'll be a pleasure. Have a great day.
Take care. Stay safe.
See you, bud. Take care.
Bye. Planet Rock.